We're going to get Mr. Bevin to say a prayer and open up.
Let's pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, in the precious name of Jesus, we gather here tonight, Lord, looking to you for guidance and leadership. Heavenly Father, we know that you're the creator of everything. You made every oyster that exists. Heavenly Father, you make the tides that keep them thriving and feeds the oysters daily. Heavenly Father, you're in charge of everything. You control everything. We realize that, Heavenly Father. But we look to you tonight for guidance and leadership and what we need to do to bring our bay back the way it once was. Heavenly Father, we know that you can do this because you can do all things, and you're a wise God. You know what we need. So, Heavenly Father, we just trust you and not our own instincts. We look to you for guidance and leadership. We love you and thank you because we know that you will provide. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Can y'all hear me without using that?
No.
Shannon.
This meeting's to inform y'all on what is going on and where we at with the relay program, shuttle program, and what's going on from the last meeting that we had. Now, we got some people that's going to come up here and tell each part what we're doing. So if y'all please listen to them, because they're just here to inform y'all. They're nobody to fuss at or holler at. You know, they're the ones trying to help us. So y'all, please give them respect, because they're not, all they can do is tell you what they have going on each project, and they don't have any of the answers. But we're a lot closer than what we were, but we're still a long way from being where we need to be. Y'all keep that in mind. So I'm going to let Mr. Joe come in up here, Joe Taylor, and explain him what's going on up at the Franklin Promise, and we'll treat it from there. I'm not following the list. Well, Ricky told me he didn't want to talk.
Yeah, I'm not talking.
And Chris? I'm going to backtrack for a minute, because I figured we'd go ahead and let them talk, and then we'll come back up here.
All right.
And we'll discuss between us.
Thank you. So first, all right, my name's Joe, and I work with Franklin's Promise Coalition. And basically, we have several things going on. I recognize a lot of you. We've been doing those needs assessments at the firehouse, us and a whole group of other partners. And the first thing I want to do is apologize to those folks that we've not gotten to yet. It's a huge task, and we have a lot of people who are interested, a lot of people who are helping, but the fact is we have about 220 folks that we need to service. We had well over about $150,000 worth of needs, and we've only collected about $27,000 so far. So it's a really big challenge to try to make sure we get the things to the people who need it the most. So we just ask that you be patient. We know that that it's really important to have things like electricity and shelter and water, and want you to know that folks are working very hard on that. But it's important to stay in touch with us. If something's happened or something's changed, you have a need, especially anything that's medical related or life and death. You know, the fact is it's sad, and it's very difficult not to have electricity, but if someone has a respirator or a medical need, we kind of have to put those things first. If those things happen to you, if something changes in your household, call us. Jim, Ricky, all of these guys, Shannon, they all know how to get a hold of us. We're at the old high school out in Apalachicola, and there's a whole team of people that are working to bring resources to us here in Franklin County. I hate to begin a list. Some of the other folks are going to speak. But really, we are the connector. So if you want to come, we can connect you to someone else. It may not be that we have the answer. It may be that we have to get back in touch with you. So one thing that I ask you is if you give us a phone number, make sure it's your very best phone number. Because sometimes when we're trying to get back, we just can't get in touch with folks. Or give us your friend so we can get a message to you. Because we know sometimes you run out of minutes or something like that. But we'll be glad to come back and answer any questions. If you have not done one of the needs assessments, you don't have to wait till the next time we do something at the firehouse. Come out to our office, and we will do that. If you have a difficulty with transportation and can't get a friend to bring you, you can call that number, and we'll see if we can get one done over the phone. So, is that okay?
Thanks, Dad.
Miss Cathy from Workforce Board is going to come up and share some information about some things that they're doing. So again, like Shannon said, we just want to make sure that everybody, please give them, you know, the respect and attention that they deserve. A lot of them have come a long way to be here, so please. Cathy Rutherford with the Workforce Board. I was raised in Franklin County. My mother was a millinder, so I've probably got kinfolk in this room that I've never met. Anyway, we are working on so many different programs. We're working with other agencies to help the people of Franklin County, to help the people that I grew up with and watched work so hard every day of my life. My Aunt Kat Steiner had probably one of the biggest oyster houses in Franklin County, and I used to sit up there and watch her bring the oysters in. And my mom was her houseman for a long time when I was a little girl. So my heart is here, even though I live in Port St. Joe, and I work here every day. And we have several programs going on. The first one is called Franklin Works. It's a training program to help place workers with employers all around Franklin County. Some of you I recognize are already involved in it. Once we get you certified eligible, you'll come in for some testing and a little bit of classroom training. And during that time, you're actually paid a training stipend of $300 per week. And when that's completed, after about 3 weeks, you'll be placed, whoever decides you want to do this, you'll be placed with an employer around Franklin County, close to where you live, so it'll be convenient for you. For 30 hours of work each week, you'll be paid $300 as a training stipend. That'll go from 3 to 6 months. Whoever wants to be involved in that, that'll be that many people off the bay will help the bay to recover during that time. Also, we noticed that so many people need their GEDs, and if you filled out the forms at the last couple of resource fairs, we want to help you get your GED. I know there's tutoring involved, and we will pay for you to do that. I don't know our particulars yet. I just heard that today from my boss, Kim Bodine. But we will pay for you to do that, probably much like what these others are being invested right now and ready for the Franklin Works program. So also, there's going to be training, and Gulf Coast State College is here, and they'll tell you more about it. We're going to have a corrections program here in Franklin County, and that's going to happen about the end of October. And so that they will bring that training here to Franklin County, and you can train to be a corrections officer right here. So they're going to tell you more about that in a few minutes. There's also going to be a CNA class at St. James Rehab Center in Carabel, and that's in the works for the ones of you that signed up that you want training to be a CNA. There's also going to be a welding class, and that's going to be in Gulf County, and we will provide transportation and vans to get you to and from. The reason that's in Gulf County is because that's where the facility is to teach the welding. And of course, we know that Eastern Shipbuilding is looking for welders as well as other folks to work with all that is coming into to Port St. Joe. So Workforce is also opening an office in East Point and in Carabel, and that's all in the works right now. So we want you to know that we're working hard to help you. Feel free to call us. We have these brochures up here that have our numbers, and we just hired a few new people to help to man these other offices. And then we also have this form. If you didn't sign up at one of the other resource fairs, please sign up with us, and we'll call you and find out what's in your heart, what you want to do, and we'll do our best to help you. Thank you. Miss Loretta is here from Gulf Coast Community College. She's going to come up now and reiterate on some of the things that Kathy was sharing.
My name is Loretta Costin, and I am with Gulf Coast State College. And I don't know how many of you are familiar with the college. The main campus is over in Panama City, but we have a campus in right on the county line between Franklin and Gulf County. And I don't know if any of you have ever been there or seen it, but we offer a lot of different programs at the campus in Gulf County, Gulf Franklin line. But what we're going to be doing, and Cathy just talked to you a little bit about it, what we want to do is bring some of the programs where we know there are jobs, so that if you enroll in the program and complete the program, that there are jobs that are available. And we want to bring them here to Franklin County, because we know sometimes that transportation to get even over to our campus might be a bit of a challenge. So the first program, and we're very close to getting this program in place, is the correctional officer training program. And Clarke Joyner, who is the coordinator of that program, is going to talk to you in just a minute about what we're doing and when we expect to start that program, and if you're interested, some of the things that you can be doing. As Kathy also mentioned, the welding program. Eastern Shipbuilding is a shipbuilding group out of Panama City. They're hiring as we speak. I know some of you were at that first resource fair, and maybe even the second one, and they were there. You may have applied. What we're doing is working with Eastern Shipbuilding to offer a welding program that is designed to make sure that you get the skills that Eastern Shipbuilding wants. And this is going to be a shorter-term welding program. And right now, we've still got some details to work out, but right now, the plan is, now that will go to St. Joe at the high school, because they already have a welding facility there. We're looking at doing that in the evenings. Now, it'd be four nights a week for 3 hours, but it's kind of a fast-track program, so that if we can get it up and running like we hope to the end of this month, that you could be completed by December and at least have those skills that Eastern Shipbuilding needs, so that you could then be qualified to get a job. We're working on that short-term program, and then looking at the possibility of putting in the full welding program. Again, it would be in the evening. Again, it would be in St. Joe at the welding facility at the high school. But again, as Kathy said, working with the workforce board on paying for that course, getting for transportation, those kinds of things. We've got a strong partnership. If you don't mind, can I just see a show of hands how many people might be interested in welding, the short-term welding? I know some of you I saw. What about longer-term welding, the full-on welding program? Okay, well, that's good, and that's what we need to know. So we're going to continue to work on that. And then also, as she mentioned, certified nursing assistant. That basically generally is a four-month program, and it prepares you to become employed as a certified nursing assistant, which is a really good job. I mean, it's a good job, good skills. You know, to work in hospitals and nursing homes, assisted living facilities. It's also the first step in a career ladder. So you go in, learn to be a certified nursing assistant, and then if you wanted to continue into licensed practical nurse, LPNs, that's a really good stepping stone. And we're working, we're not sure if it's going to be at the St. John's Rehab Hospital in Carabelle, there or somewhere else in Franklin County, but we're working to put that in place because we understand there's a need for CNAs in Franklin County, and that way you don't have to travel to Gulf County or Panama City. So working to put those programs in. So those are the three. We're working as fast as we can to get them in place quickly so you can get in, get trained, get the skills, and then be able to become employed. I'll turn it over to Clark now. He's going to talk to you in a little bit more detail about the correction officer training program.
I'm Clark Joyner. I'm the corrections coordinator actually at North Bay, but I'm thinking about coming back down to Port St. Joe where I can be closer to the area. I've been in contact with the Department of Corrections to use their facility up at the prison in Carabelle for the first class that we want to hold in Franklin County. That way you don't have to come to us, we come to you, with the exception of 1 month. So you can get two-thirds of the training here in Franklin County for that 1 month. I'm going to be working with workforce and other agencies to try to get transportation. They won't allow us to do our firearms training or our defensive tactics training there because of liability issues. We've got the contract in. The lawyers are looking at it now to have a mutual agreement between the college and the Department of Corrections. I don't foresee many roadblocks in that. Hopefully we'll have that ready and up ready to go within the next month. Hopefully by the end of the month, as Kathy said, but more likely it'll probably be the first or second week in November. But we will come to you to put the training on north of Carabel. I know the people in Appalachia is about as close to go to St. Joe as it is to go to Carabel. But this is short term. This is not very much prior notice, and we had to put together something as quickly as we could. What I can guarantee is that you'll get the best training available to help you pass the state board to become a certified officer. I have preliminary discussions with the Department of Corrections. They got a 10% lapse factor now that they have to hold 10% of their positions open. However, they've got an empty work camp sitting up there on site right now that we anticipate will open sometime in April. Right now, the Department of Corrections is offering, let me say, they start at $31,000 a year. Got medical benefits, got a retirement benefit. You only pay 3% in. It's good. I retired from the department. I did 30 years with them. It treated me and my family well. Young as needed shoes, I could buy them because I knew I had a steady paycheck every 2 weeks. Prisons don't close for oil spills. They don't close for natural disasters. They don't close, period. Once they're open, they're open. So it's a way that you can have a job with some benefits here in your own county, okay? The requirements, I'll be at the fire station tomorrow night at 6 o'clock. We're having a meet and greet there. I'll have all the informational packets for you. I'll have the application packets for you then. We can sit down, we can discuss it at length. As long as it takes, I'll be there with you. That's my promise to you. That's what the college wants to do, because we are Gulf Franklin Center out of Port St. Joe. Franklin's half of our job. But me, I've got a house over here in Eastport, so it's kind of near and dear to me too. All right. One of the things that we really, really want to try to do is get the transportation, because we are going to have to go to our firing range. It's in Southport. It's north of Panama City. And we are going to have to do our defensive tactics training either at Gulf Franklin Center or up there. I might do them at the same time at our North Bay campus. That way, if we can get your transportation over, you'll do 4 hours on the range, you'll do 4 hours in defensive tactics, come back. We'll be finished that in 1 month. The other 2 months, all the other classroom training, we will do right here at the prison for the time being. That's our site, unless something happens and they pull the plug on it, which I don't anticipate that happening. I'll be here tomorrow night, like I say, 6 o'clock, Eastport Fire Station, to answer any questions that you might have. Anybody got any questions right now? Okay. Thank you.
Oh, one other question.
Sorry. We're going to have these flyers. It explains what we're doing. It's got contact information and all that at the bottom. The telephone numbers that you can call. This telephone number, I let her go to the mountains this week. So there might not be an answer unless I get it forwarded to my phone, which I'm going to be between Panama City, St. Joe, and East Point, the Red Ranger, this week. So if I don't get back to you immediately, I will get back to you as soon as I can. That's my promise to you, okay? Yes, sir. That's what she just explained just then, the welding program, the CNA, stuff like that.
Ms. Vicki Abrams was going to be here from DCF for anybody that may have questions regarding Department of Children and Families. She wasn't able to make it, but she is still reachable through the department. I have her business card at home. You guys can get my number from me. Call me. I'll get you in touch with her. And then Franklin Promises, like Joe said, is always a great place to go. I know they are doing work with people for food stamps, different things like that. They did a training course that I participated in, volunteered my time. So if you guys want to get with me too, I don't want to bring work and home together, you know, but if you guys need some help, I do have the ability to help you do some of that also. So Mr. Bill Mahan is going to come up and share some information. And then Andy Kane is here from the University of Florida. So we'll let Mr. Bill talk, and then Andy will come up and talk as well.
Hi everyone, my name is Bill Mahan, and I'm with the Franklin UFIFAS Extension Program. My office is in the Armory. And I'm here to tonight to just let you know about a couple different things that are going on. A number of people said they're a little confused, so hopefully we can straighten it out. How many of you heard about the informal listening session for tomorrow? Okay, just a couple. Well, there's going to be an informal listening session by, it's sort of a multi-university, but it's set up by the University of Florida. It's called Healthy Gulf, Healthy Communities. And they want folks to come in and tell them what their concerns are about the current situation. And we'll also have a number of scientists that are part of the Bay Recovery Team that will be meeting on Wednesday. And so, for anyone who wants to come in and voice their concerns or talk to some of the scientists that will be working, trying to figure out what's going on here in the Bay, here's an opportunity. Be at the Armory from 5:30 until 7 tomorrow night. And just very informal. And then a week from tomorrow, which will be the 16th, they'll have a more formal session, and there'll be two sessions for that. From 2 to 4, and then from 5:30 to 7, and they're the same thing, but on a more formal. Yes, sir?
Aren't they having the same kind of meeting at this point at the estuary also, like the day after tomorrow?
That's Wednesday. That's for more of the science research team, and there's a number of local folks who are involved in that too, so like Shannon and Ricky and Chris have all been invited to attend that. But really what that meeting is the scientists that one of my bosses at the University of Florida has put together to look at the studies that have been done and identify some of the holes, maybe some of the research that needs to get done. And in the second year, I'll have Dr. Andy Kane come up. He's doing some of the work here, and that's already started. But as Carl Haven said, the Wednesday meeting is just going to be a dry science-type meeting. But one of the reasons to have the informal listening session on Tuesday night is to provide feedback from the community to the scientific group as to some of their issues. Oh yeah, you can go to either, but I don't think the one at the research reserve is going to be one for much discussion. It's going to be probably a lot of review of what research has been done and some of the things that need to be done to answer some of the questions that are being asked. So, but yes, I mean, certainly welcome to come. Any?
Well, like on that you talking about tomorrow, are they going to do anything like what they've done in Panama? I think what they call sand porn pass there in Panama City. They voted on it, got it shut down. They filled it in and closed it off. Actually, we need to do something like that with Bob Sides Pass. And, shut it back.
Yeah, well, I would say that.
So we can keep our water, what little bit of fresh water Georgia's giving us, we can keep it. Right now, to stand, salt water coming in, but it's killing it.
Right.
I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. Panama City can close their pass down. I wonder why we can't shut our pass down.
Right. Well, I would say the Tuesday night meeting is a good time to bring that up. Because you're going to have a bunch of, say, researchers, scientists from around the state who really aren't that familiar with what's going on here and what our local issues are. So.
That would help us a lot. Within 3 years, you'll see this bay come back just by shutting down one pass. And if you take over in Cat Point East Hole and open up some of that field up there, y'all got the birds, get some of that fresh water going that way, could help too. You'll see this bay come back about 3 years. We'll just keep what we're doing with the guy.
But I'd say that's exactly the type of information that the scientists are hoping to hear.
Plant the shells. I got another thing on planting shells. Don't let them shells sit out there 90 days. Shove them out one day, put them in the bay the next. the very next year you can catch oysters right there. Because it's bat will live. There's several things we can do to improve our bay right now for next year and the year after that. We won't have to do all this filtering as well.
Yes, thank you.
Those questions right there are the questions we need for tomorrow night. I mean, really can't answer those questions, but those are the questions we want for tomorrow night, because they got all the, you know what I mean, that's where those answers need to be, questions need to be asked, because Bill can't answer none of them. You know, but that's why he was informing, right, informing you, then tomorrow you get to bring all your questions up.
Tomorrow would be the perfect time for that, as well as if you wanted to come back a week from tomorrow for the more formal listening sessions, those would probably be two very good opportunities.
Sorry, I just mean in real time, I just making sure that I mean, that
needs to be said. Yes, sir. No, I agree. That's the type of stuff everyone who wants to have a voice should come and attend these meetings and let the scientists know what your feelings are, what that's going on locally. So, any other questions for me, or should I introduce Dr. Andy Kane? He's with the University of Florida, Emerging Pathogens Institute, and he's working, I guess, on both. He's both on the scientific bay recovery team as well as part of the research, one of the researchers on the Healthy Gulf, Healthy Communities Initiative. So, Dr. Andy?
Good evening, everybody.
Dr. Kane.
I am very honored to be here this evening, and I'm coming in from Gainesville, and I am part of our College of Public Health and Health Professions Department of Environmental and Global Health, and I'm a fish biologist by training, but I've been doing a lot of stuff in the last 5 years since I've been here in Florida, focusing on how the environment affects aquatic resources and how these resources and seafood relates to public health. And I am one of three different researchers in this Healthy Gulf, Healthy Communities project. And the project that I'm focusing on is seafood safety. And it was funded by the federal government. It was funded by the National Institutes of Environmental Health Sciences. And that is separate from any other entity. Right? It's not related to BP, it is related to public health, right? That's what that institute is all about. And I wanted to take a minute or so and tell you about the project that I'm working on. And I want to tell you about it not because I have the need to come here and tell you, but because some of this project may relate to you and hopefully may be able to offer you something that can either be a bright spot or maybe as part of a larger team may help to rebuild some of the oyster fishery that I know has been so devastated this summer and in the recent year. So the project that I'm working on is really based on the way our country looked at the oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico. What happened was after the oil spill, which was a really big deal, I mean, this was not something that I'm just bringing up, I mean, this was a huge thing that happened, and it had both environmental outcomes, including potentially fisheries, and it has potential public health outcomes. And the only thing that I'm supported to come here to talk about really is the public health outcomes. But I'm a biologist, so I care about the environmental outcomes too. They're both important to me. And my project is designed to ask the very simple question, what is the potential outcome of that oil spill relative to people who live right along the Gulf Coast, people who have lived along the Gulf Coast all their lives, people who enjoy living there, and part of that is also enjoying eating seafood from the Gulf, and people who do enjoy eating seafood from the Gulf tend to eat a fair amount of it. When they have it, they'll eat it, because it's great. And I know that even living landlocked in Gainesville, I eat more than twice the national average of what most people in this country eat for seafood. And I'll bet you I don't eat nearly as much as many people that live right around here or along with some of the Gulf Coast counties. And I'm not suggesting that people who eat more seafood are at greater risk. Right? To make risk happen, you have to have two things. You have to have an exposure of something, right? To make risk happen, you have to have an exposure to something, and then you have to have something that's nasty enough to have an exposure to, right? So if I have pure, clear spring water, which has no risk, you could be exposed to that all day and all night, and it's not going to have a problem.
And the water and the food.
Come again?
And the water and the food.
The water.
Underground, through the surface, we pop it in, and we drink it. And we eat.
No, absolutely. And it, so, and nothing is simple. Nothing is simple. So the bottom line is I'm looking at risk, where I believe right now there's not much, if any, exposure. As a matter of fact, we've collected data.
East of here, I have no data from Apalachicola yet, but I'm going to share that information with you briefly. But the bottom line is my goal is to come out to the counties as I go along the Gulf Coast from Florida, heading along the Panhandle into Alabama, and then heading west. And we're sampling seafood with the help of communities. Communities here today, we've had folks from the Seafood Workers Association who have graciously contributed to our project, and we've gone out to fishing tournaments, and we're working with anglers, and we're collecting fish
and
samples.
We're analyzing those seafood products that includes finfish and blue crab and different species of shrimp and oyster.
And we're looking for the same type of contaminants that were looked at by NOAA and the U.S. Food and Drug Administration.
But the only difference is we're looking at inshore caught seafood, not the stuff that's 3 miles offshore and beyond.
And we're looking also at the rate that people consume that seafood living in these counties close to the Gulf, where they enjoy living there and they enjoy eating the seafood, and maybe eating more than the national average. So we're redoing the risk assessments on a community basis. So that's my project as part of this Healthy Gulf, Healthy Communities program. The other two projects are dealing with individual and community resiliency. And that's really important, right? The ability to overcome a lot of tough times, even crises. And with my collaborators, and thanks to Joe Taylor and Franklin's Promise, and also Bill Mann, there's an opportunity, should you want to participate in the resiliency studies, and you should go talk to Joe about that. I think they have an incentive, a thank you gift to help you out if you wanted to participate with that. There's a survey. So anyway, we're sampling today. I want to let you know that we're here. We're sampling your seafood. I'm making sure that I'm sampling it by having some for dinner as well. And we're having this listening session tomorrow night. And it's important that if you've got concerns that either you'd like to talk about, or that, more importantly, you'd like us to hear as scientists, we want to gather that information, and we want to use that information to sort of understand in a bigger sense what people are thinking here in Apalachicola, and what your concerns are, both about the environment, about the oyster fishery, and about other things, about your health, your community's health. And that's only going to, it's going to be a short meeting, but that'll be tomorrow night at the Armory at 5:30. And please come and join us. We're going to have some snacks and drinks. And think about what you would like to share if there's something of concern on your mind. And we want to hear that. And that is also going to set a tone for a community forum that the University of Florida and this project is hosting on October 16th. And that will also be in the Armory. So that'll be a longer program, but it will be based on what we hear during this listening session tomorrow night. So it's not as though we're coming in and saying, this is what we do and we're going to help you. It's more about, what are the issues that you're dealing with, and we would like to see if we have the expertise to contribute to helping you. So I'm honored to really be here, and I look forward to seeing you guys tomorrow night. If you have any questions, I'll be around for a little while here. And thank you for your attention.
I've got oysters 30-some-odd years in oyster similar bays to the east of here. How come the Marine Patrol are coming up and smelling your oysters instead of checking the site?
So I'm going to give you a quick answer for now.
and I'll be happy to talk with you, but these are questions that please join us tomorrow because we want to capture this in a more formal way. Your question, tell me if I got this right, your question is how come folks are sniffing oysters rather than testing them to see what's inside?
You know, she's in rings on checking for the size oysters that you have. They are smelling oysters to see if they smell like gas, oil, or diesel.
Andy's going to be here if y'all want to talk with him, but so that we can move the meeting forward. We want to share some other pieces of that. Andy spoke about the resiliency component. We have two researchers from the University of Maryland here as well. And some of you have already participated in that particular survey. And if you're interested, we have appointments that we're booking. They're at 8:30 in the morning, 11:30 at lunch, and 3 in the afternoon. So I have appointments available on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. If you're interested in doing that, please see me and I'll get your number and information. And that's a one-on-one interview with the folks from the University of Maryland. And as Andy said, you do get a $50 gift card at the end. It takes about 2 hours. So it's not a bad gig. One other piece I want to make sure y'all know, food pantries tomorrow in Apalachicola at the old high school is a distribution. So make sure that if there's a need that you have there, that you're welcome to come out. From Thursday, you go to Carabel at the Methodist Church, and Saturday back here with the folks at the Baptist Church. So just remember that schedule.
And y'all got to keep in mind that Amy was doing the research, sampling our product to see if there's anything in it. He's not with FWC. What FWC does, they have no clue. They're just, you know, sampling or catching them.
Well, they called and they said that meat was leaking out of the shape. I was wondering if anybody knew about that.
So I went over there and oystered, and it's like I'm talking as always. You know, most of it's dead, like our bait.
Right.
But
there wasn't no meat.
You know, it looks like our bait, basically, but it all looked like.
What is it?
Yeah, I do want to say something. We're taking a long time to get funded for Relay to Shelling. It's fine trying to find the money to get Relay to Shelling. It's coming slow. We're dealing with federal. It's coming. When, I can't tell you. It's going to, and it's, hopefully at the end of this month, it's going to be close. But, you know, we're dealing with a slow situation. No funding. Might have funding. The application was turned in today for the funding. I guess it'd be the end of the week before we even know where that's going. So, yes, sir.
What the shelling, I understand that word, what that does. But relay, what you going to say? They don't wear a relay from that like dead.
On the jetties area, around the river ship panel, where the boys are distilling, are good.
Well, yeah, but
no, they're not. I went there and checked them. They all half of them dead, too.
Oh, well.
So you can't tell me that.
A lot of them getting
they get oysters, yeah, I know they are. But I checked them at the summer barns and they were dying then.
But we're still going to where to study. We have a study done. Well, we didn't have a study at all.
Oh, yeah,
that's
good. Yeah.
So right now we got keeping what's in hand that we can prove. As soon as the study gets done, we got something.
We don't close this bay.
Excuse me, who are you?
Mark Williams.
Mark Williams, okay.
Yeah. We don't close it. The angel says even worried about this bay no more.
But if we don't get funding for us to stay here and work, what are we going to do?
You're going to be moving away pretty soon anyway.
Well, I hope not. I'm gonna try my best to stay right here. I'm gonna do everything in my power. Born and raised right here, and I plan on staying here. I don't plan on going nowhere.
I've worked here all my life. But if we don't shut this bay down and get some federal help in here, we don't have a bay.
Exactly. That's where we're at. We're trying to get federal help first. When we get federal help, then we'll try to get together and have. But we've got to have help first. You know, I plan on trying to get on this shipyard where until the bay gets better, I can come back. I've been off the water before. I can get off the water again, but I want to come back to it. That's my passion. I love the water. I like being self-employed. You know, but we can't just say let's close the bay down. We got to have something to keep going. You know, all right, we get the bay closed tomorrow. Well, then what? I mean, where are you gonna go get a fine job? You can't go to.
Well, I went out yesterday and caught four bays. I'm really making a living, right?
No, but nobody making a living.
No, I'm actually paying on my gas to go out there.
$140 times seven is over $800 a week. Can't live off $800 a week, you got a problem.
We need
I do the same thing every day. I'm making a living.
I hope you are making a living. I damn sure not. I'm not going to work damn two bags of oysters all day long to kill myself for two bags.
No good.
Well,
no
listen, can I say something, please? Now, I don't work on the water like you guys do, but my husband does. And two and a half years ago, he built a brand new boat. Everybody in this room is on the same situation you are, but here's what we're saying. We have talked to different people about what we're going to do about the oysters, because if they're dead one place, they're dead here, they're dead there. That's what Andrew and Bill are here to help us find out, number one. Number two, FWC has already talked to us and offered to do what they could on their end as a marine fishery. I don't know what that is. Number three, our county commissioners are even here right now trying to help represent you guys. But if you go in there, just like they said, if we can still work, then work. If we work during an oil spill, then why not work right now? The situation is when these guys get done with their research, if there's a bigger problem, because just like with the relay and some of our options, they may, who knows, maybe we can relay out of closed waters a small sample and find out if it is going to kill them. Because if it's going to kill them anyway, then it's a water quality issue. But we don't know that. But to put everybody in this room out of work, if you can go and make two bags a day, no, that's not a whole lot of money. And I agree, and I totally agree with you, but something is better than nothing. And that's what we are here for. If you don't, just like these people that are here offering to help you, if you're having a hard time with work and you don't want to go make a living and you can't afford to work on the water, go talk with Cathy from Workforce. Go talk with Miss Loretta from Gulf Coast Community College. There are options short term. And if we shut this bay down and nobody's out there working, then you do not have the physical presence that you need to get the people in here that are willing to help. Our governor just came to East Point Wednesday. I didn't get the pleasure of meeting him, but he came to see y'all. And he served food on his own. Without y'all striving to work and not just sitting back waiting on a free paycheck, then nobody's going to help you.
I'm not waiting on nobody.
I know you, but that's what I'm saying is everybody in this room feels the same
way. What I'm looking at, I know in Georgia, I used to shrimp for a living. Mm-hmm. I've done it for 25 years. Mm-hmm. They shut Georgia down. They paid everybody to help replant it, just like you would want the oysters replanted. They come over here and got our shrimp out of this bays and all this and took over there. Now they got the best white shrimp they ever had. But they've got rules and regulations. You don't work at daytime. You only work when they tell you to. But they make good money. I ain't saying shut it down forever. I'm saying we need to do something quick before it's gone.
Well, that's why we're here tonight. That's why we're telling you we have ideas. We have projects. But it is not an overnight thing. The guys were out today on the water with Andy and them collecting samples right now today trying to find those solutions. So please, we know it's not easy. That's why we tell y'all. You guys can contact, if you have an idea that we don't know about, you can contact Marine Patrol, you can contact FWC, you can contact Department of Agriculture and Consumer Services, you can contact Joe, you can contact anybody on your own, because we are only five of us. We represent 800 of you, and five compared to 800, that's a big shift in making a difference.
We're also trying to get a committee, as you want to call it. What are we calling it, Chris?
SMART.
SMART.
Yes, sir.
go ahead, you know, you got it.
What we're trying to do is we're trying to come up with a committee that we're trying to put together. It's called SMART. It's Seafood Management Assistant Restore Team. And we're working on that. That brings all agencies, us, the county commissioners, everybody to a round table. If we get this going, it'll help us a lot. It'll keep us from hitting the brick wall every time we turn around. It's important. Well, decisions like that will come before this board.
Four bags of oysters, 3 inches long today.
But,
no.
I mean, we're trying, man. We're doing all we can do. No, ma'am, not right now. Because we just come up with it, trying to get it going. As soon as we do know more about it, we'll be able to fill you in.
What'd you say?
I said, so bringing in one bag of legal oysters and 3 bags of illegal oysters is doing the best we can do?
Nobody said that. No. We're all in the same boat. We all.
Hello.
And then y'all, like I said, my business goes right behind y'all. I work at an RV resort. I work in tourism. If there's no seafood, there's no tourism. Nobody's going to come down here, and all of our snowbirds are on their way down. And don't think they don't know. Y'all got more support coming from a whole different part of the country. And God love them, because they come down here, and that's what they want to do. And I've made relationships with people that live up north that are coming down here. They'll be down here next month, December, January, and they're like, what are we going to do for seafood? We're like, we're working on it. But call your congressman, call your senators. Ms. Marsh is here from Senator Montford's office. So the more people, the longer we keep it stirred up, but being respectful, the more we're going to get done. But you have to just bear, we're only a small group of people. But no, I understand your point. It bothers us too. But we don't know what to do. That's why we've called everybody else here to try to help.
If we went to FWC tomorrow and asked them to crack down hard, they could crack down hard. And nobody would be making nothing. Because you can't go. There's exactly right now. Could you imagine if the rent control would get out there and start hitting you real hard? Right. But it needs to happen. It's got to happen. But we got to get some funding. And that's where we at, trying to find funding. We get some funding, then we're going to say, FWC needs to do your job. We're going to say, we need you back in the dealer's coolers. You know, that's when we can say, hit hard, do something about it, stop it. But you got something to pay your light bill. You got something to pay your mortgage, you know. Without having something to pay our bills, you know, we're cutting our own throats. But yeah, we can go to FWC tomorrow. But if we do...
How many people that are working in the bay right now, every day oystering, think that closing the bay down is going to be our answer right now?
No.
I'd
starve to death if I couldn't go get my
we would lose everything we got.
How many people that are working in the bay right now think that we need to get some assistance in here before we even think of closing our bay? Yeah.
And that's
all we can do. All we can do is speak for the majority of the people. If you go out there and choose to take an illegal product, then that's on you. We can't control that. If you're worried about the bait, go out there and catch what legal product you can and feed your family that night. But closing the bay and having no income for every family in this community is not the answer. It may not be the answer to leave it open and everybody towed it off, but we can't monitor everybody. Everybody's got to monitor themselves, do what you think is right for the bay, and take care of your family. But you can't come in, four of us go and say, how many people are going to come to us if we go to FWC tomorrow and say, we want the bay closed? And we're speaking for all of you. So, once again, everybody that's oystering every day, raise your hand if you want us to go to FWC and have the bay closed. Alright, if you want the bay to stay open and you're oystering every day, nobody that ain't oystering, raise your hand if you think we need to leave it open until we get some assistance. Then that's the way we feel.
Hey,
And there was a boy here a while ago that was wanting to vote us out. So does anybody else here feel that way about any one of us?
No.
If you do speak up now, I will step down the ladder.
Yes.
We're doing everything we can, and all we can do is run our mouth. That's all we got is our mouth. We don't have nothing else. But I'm going to tell you, we are a pain in the butt. We are a pain in the butt because we talk and talk everybody we can.
I
didn't
tell you the other day, Shannon, y'all doing it. We know what you're doing.
And that's the only thing we know to do. I mean, I don't know. But listen. Yeah. We just got to stay here and stay strong and get through it. And that's what we want to do. We might have to get off the water for a little while and do something else for a little while. I've done it before, I can do it again. If I want to, but I will. But I'll probably most likely come back. But we've got to get some help, get this bay healthy. Find out what's wrong with this bay. We got steps. We got study doing now. We're going tomorrow to finish it. We're going to 5 areas of the bay to get ultra samples. We're going to cover from one end to the other end of the bay. We're going to the east and west end, all the way down to the miles, and we're hitting everything in between.
What would be real good is if them storms that twisted up in here, screwed stuff up, was the cause of this instead of that oil. Yeah, that would
we
be
know
nice.
It did. There ain't no if. We know the storm did.
And they're going now. Maybe they're going to come back exactly. And it's going to be good.
But we still facing the same thing. We ain't getting no fresh water. And we're still going to be battling with that. And we're still battling with that. I go up to Atlanta and up to Georgia all the time on meetings. And we're fighting for some fresh water. Not through the state. This is independent studies. Yes, I am a member of the ACF stakeholders. The Apalachicola, Flint, Chattahoochee River.
For y'all. We represent y'all.
This association pays my dues of $250 where I can be our voice. The last meeting I went up there, I asked for some more fresh water. Of course, we didn't get it, but I asked for it. I told them, I've read the presentation of what we're facing in our bay, what it's doing to us, but we're dealing with Atlanta. And I'm going to tell you, they got a lot of deep pockets.
They do.
When we get the results from University of Florida, they will be posted. We will put them on the Facebook. But we need to get some brochures printed out, and we'll have a meeting and hand out the results.
Yeah, that way.
But as soon as we know something, they will be put on the Franklin County Work Association Facebook. No. And these guys are doing an independent study for us where they keep on saying in our channel, those oysters out here got mercury in them. We think we'll find out they got mercury in them.
So.
No. How long will it take, you think? An idea about how long are we looking at? A month?
So the kind of analyses that we're going to be running take a really long time. It can take up to a month to process them, and we're going to try to move it along. We're going to be doing a lot more than we typically would be doing. But when we do this, we're going to provide feedback directly to the Seafood Workers Association, but we're also going to come back. I will be coming back, and we'll get together as a community to be able to talk about those results. Because just throwing data back at you and say, well, go ahead and compare this to other data that you may have seen, to me is meaningless. So it's our intent to come back. So the time frame for that is going to be tricky. We're going to try to push this along as quickly as we can, but it's going to be months before we can come back and have a community interaction again.
That tree we're not dealing with. We're not, that tree, this is totally
separate. So, and they've got croaker, butterfish, speckled trout, croaker, flounder, redfish, speckled trout with the fish that we got for sample. We got four different samples of shrimp. We got blue crab samples. And tomorrow we're going to get the oyster samples. So it's not, and we're sampling all the way across the board. So it's not just, we should know something. Excuse me? Well, that wasn't on their study, but they do have a couple of mud. And hopefully tomorrow, if he wants, we'll get some more mud. Y'all have anything else y'all think that we can address?
I got something. Shannon.
Yes, sir.
We shelled before we kept this bay mm-hmm. down at 8 Mile. Mm-hmm. And I think if we can get shelling here, we need to get the bay.
That's what we're pushing. And we want to meet with the relay. But yeah, okay. So, say the oysters are right by the jetties is dying. But there are better oysters than anywhere else in the bay. You know, so if we can move these oysters, this is what we're trying to do. If we can move these oysters in an area, it's winter bar area. FWC is going to monitor them for 3 weeks. At the end of those 3 weeks, we'll be able to go catch them. So that will be that day's work, and that'll be 3 weeks later work. You know, and that's all we can do. We can just.
How about dual side? I know they've run a grab before. Is there anything they can do to get that open up going in relay?
The last time I was in there wasn't a whole lot of relay in there, but I think that the state park got it where we're not allowed to go in there anymore. I think that's state parks is through state, but get right here, this back to our channel right here, we get that proof good oysters, we've been putting them on cat point, and what's big enough to catch 3 weeks we get to catch, and what ain't we'll grow later. You know, all I know to do is do what is in hand that can be done. And as far as I know. I know some boys have been getting caught on there. And I mean, it must be good enough to take the chance because it's a felony. You know, I think if you got a fine or anything, they take you to jail. They don't know. I know 12 have been arrested.
And,
you know, so I haven't been there. If the guy sitting here said he has. But for them to be wanting to steal, they must be something.
No, I'm talking about spacing anybody in the past. Have y'all checked up in there, said they alive in coon oysters?
I ain't been down there. We're going to Lake Mile tomorrow to check to get oyster samples. So I can run in there and look. I couldn't answer that question. I ain't been in there. Has anybody been down in there? Who's spacing down in the mile? I hadn't been past 11 Mile. You know.
Paradise. Paradise.
I hadn't been paradise.
I learned all I could learn today, Terry. Good to see you, brother.
Just you and Barney Twain.
I went out and fished.
Miss Cheryl, you want to say anything? But listen, we got our county commission support. We do. Believe me, we got their ear anytime. We can call them. Y'all can call them. You know, we have their support. You want to say anything?
They ever tested the water on one side's closed, one side's open. We don't have the fresh water anymore. Why can't they open?
We did. We talked to Dax about that. That right there on that river channel that's permanently closed. We asked them about that. And of course, you know, they're going to throw us a line. They said that they can start sampling it. But they probably in bad sample because the river flow is so low. But it'd be a 10-year process. We ain't got 10 years. So we're going to try to focus on moving them.
will probably relate. You already in the voting. Time we get
sure, Pat.